with great virtue, out of compassion, for the sake of this assembly and all living beings, please turn the wonderful Dharma wheel to teach us how to leave suffering and attain bliss and end birth and death, and quickly realize number.
Namo Sadanto Suche Doye Alaihati Samyao Sambutoshe.
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 Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yan Jing Hua Yan Hai Hui Fo Fu Sa.
Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yan Jing Hua Yan Hai Hui Fo Fu Sa.
Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yan Jing Hua Yan Hai Hui Fo Fu Sa.
Namo Da Fang Guang Fo Hua Yan Jing Hua Yan Hai Hui Fo Fu Sa. Homage to the Buddha's Flower Garland Sutra of great expansive teachings. And the ocean-wide flower garland assembly of Buddhas and Bodhisattvas.
Wu Sang Shen Shen Wei Miao Fa Bai Qian Wan Jie Nan Zao Yu. Wo Jin Jian Wen De Shou Chi, Yuan Jie Ru Lai Zhen Shi Yi.
The unsurpassed, deep, profound, subtle, wonderful Dharma in 100,000 million eons is difficult to encounter. Now that I've come to receive and hold it within my sight and hearing, I vow to fathom the Thus Come One's true and actual meaning.
上人、各位法师、还有各位佛友，大家阿弥陀佛。今天是2014年1月25日，星期六的晚上。现在是在加州伯克莱圣寺。今晚呢，我们继续一起来研究《大方广佛华严经》实地品。那现在我们已经到第五地的南圣地。
Good evening, everyone. We all, the Venerable Masters, and Dharma friends, welcome to Berkeley Buddhist Monastery. We're here in California on January 25th, 2014, and we are studying the Avatamsaka Sutra, the Flower Garland Sutra. We're on the chapter called the Ten Grounds. We are currently on the fifth ground, and it's named the Ground of Difficult Conquest.
现在我们的经文是照中文本的48页，第二段，佛子菩萨注释南圣地开始。所以首先呢，我们会把这两段经文用中文读一次，那用英文也读一次。So
we're on page 48 in the Chinese, the second paragraph. It starts with 佛子菩萨, and so that corresponds to page 49 in the English, where it starts with disciples of the Buddha. So what we do is we traditionally read the Chinese and then we read the English together.
在中文的部分，那我就读了，大家跟着读啊。So
please read along with me as I read the Chinese.
佛子，菩萨住世南圣地，以愿力故，得见多佛。
得见多佛，所谓见多百佛，见多千佛，乃至见多百千亿那由他佛， 乃至见多百千亿那由他佛，
悉恭敬尊重，
悉恭敬尊重，
诚是供养，
诚是供养，
衣服饮食卧具汤药，
衣服饮食卧具汤药，
一切资生，
一切自身，
悉以奉施，
悉以奉施，
亦供养一切众生，
亦以供养一切众生，
以此善根，
以此善根，
回向阿耨多罗三藐三菩提，
回向阿耨多罗三藐三菩提，
于诸佛手，
于诸佛手，
恭敬听法，
恭敬听法，
闻以受持，
闻以受持，
随力修行，
随力修行，
复于彼诸佛法中，
复于彼诸佛法中，
而得出家，
而得出家，
即出家矣，
即出家矣，
又更闻法，
又更闻法，
得陀罗尼，
得陀罗尼，
为文殊法师，
为文殊法师，
住此地中，
住此地中，
精于百劫，
精于百劫，
精于千劫，
精于千劫，
乃至无量百千亿，
乃至无量百千亿，
那由他劫，
那由他劫，
所有善根，
所有善根，
转更明净，
转更明净。Disciples of the, read it together. Disciples of the Buddha.When the Bodhisattva dwells upon this, the ground of difficult conquest, through the power of his vows, he comes to see many Buddhas. That is, he sees many hundreds of Buddhas, many thousands of Buddhas, many hundreds of thousands of Buddhas, up to and including seeing many hundreds of thousands of kotis of Nayutas of Buddhas. He worships and reveres them.Attends upon and makes offerings to them all, using clothing, food and drink, bedding and medicines, all of the necessities of life, completely offering them up. He makes offerings as well to all members of the Sangha, and taking those good roots, he transfers them all to Anuttara Samyak Sambodhi. In the presence of all those Buddhas, he reverently listens to the Dharma. Having heard it,He accepts and holds it, and according to his power, cultivates. Furthermore, within all Buddha's dharmas, he comes to leave the home life, and having left the home life, hears dharma even more, attains dharani, and becomes a hearing and maintaining dharma master. He dwells upon this ground, passing through hundreds of kalpas, passing through thousands of kalpas,up to and including limitless hundreds of thousands of kotis of Nayutas of Kalpas, and all of his good roots becomes ever brighter and more pure.
我们现在开始来研究这一段经文。那么首先呢，这个金刚藏菩萨就称了一声说佛子，就是针对解脱月菩萨。那么这个佛子呢，有很这个重大的意义的，因为在佛经里头呢，这个佛子专指的就是菩萨。那么什么样的人才有资格被称为这个佛子呢？第一个就是要行菩萨道、发菩提心的菩萨。那另外一种是要受菩萨戒，如果受了菩萨戒，那时候就是开始发菩提心，要行菩萨道，那最后就是要成佛，所以这时候呢也可以被称为佛子。
So here, Vajra Treasury Bodhisattva calls out, he says, disciples of the Buddha, or you could say sons of the Buddha or children of the Buddha. And what this means is actually quite meaningful. It refers to the bodhisattvas. And who is a bodhisattva? Well, a bodhisattva is those who cultivate the bodhisattva path, who have made the Bodhi resolve. And you can also say have taken the bodhisattva precepts.They, by taking the Bodhisattva precepts, enter onto cultivating the Bodhisattva path.
在我们一般凡夫如果要成为一位菩萨的话，那一定要发菩提心。这个菩提心就是觉悟的心，觉悟的心就是 过去呢是迷了，现在呢我要反迷归觉，那同时呢要自立自觉，这个自立自觉以后呢也要能够利他来觉他，来帮助所有的众生也能够觉悟，因此能够发菩提心的众生呢就开始呢能够行菩萨道了。可是呢如果众生呢因为这个菩提心发了以后呢不坚固，常常会退转，所以呢最好的方法就是要受戒，受菩萨戒。那在梵网经呢就讲到说呢，众生受佛戒即入诸佛位，未同大觉语，是名真佛子。就是说如果一个众生，我们的凡夫，那么受了佛戒，这个佛戒呢指的就是菩萨戒，受了菩萨戒发菩提心呢就怎么样即入诸佛位，受了这个菩萨戒马上呢就进入到这个诸佛的这种果位了，就是佛呢给我们受记，你受菩萨戒将来呢一定会证得这个佛的果位。那么未同大觉语，这个他的果位呢就像一个大觉悟的这种圣者，就是佛了，就是说他果位呢跟佛是同等的，是名真佛子。所以呢受了菩萨戒以后就真正的这个佛子的，就是真正的佛弟子。
So for an ordinary living being, to become a bodhisattva, what does one have to do? Well, for sure, you have to make the resolve for bodhi, to wake up, to go towards the awakened mind. It's going from our delusion, because living beings, we're often deluded. We need to turn our delusion around and go towards awakening. And by cultivating, we are able to truly help ourselves as well as awaken ourselves to wake up, but also we need to truly benefit other people and also help other people wake up. That's cultivating the bodhisattva path. So if we can cultivate in this way, then we can go towards bodhi. Now, as ordinary living beings, oftentimes we retreat from our initial resolve. We aren't solid. And so what do we do? We can take the bodhisattva precepts. Now the bodhisattva precepts help support us. And in the Brahmanet Sutra, which describes the bodhisattva precepts, there is a verse. It says, those who take the bodhisattva precepts immediately enter the Buddha's position. Their place is just like the Buddha's. And this is truly called the Buddha's disciples. And so to explain, we, as the ordinary living beings, can take the bodhisattva precepts. And upon taking these precepts, we immediately enter the Buddha's position. Reason is because, for sure, when we take the bodhisattva precepts, that plants a seed. And in the future, we will realize Buddhahood. And so then we enter to the Buddha's position. And this, you can say, is truly the Buddha's disciple, or truly the children of the Buddha.
菩萨住是南圣地，现在这个菩萨呢已经修行到第五地了，到南圣地，以愿力故，以过去他宿世的这所发的愿力，得见多佛，他能够见到很多很多的佛，所谓见多百佛，可以见到呢很多的一百、两百、三百、八百、九百这样这么多的佛，见多千佛，也可以见到一千、两千、三千，或是呢七千、八千、九千，这个意思说这个菩萨很自在，他要见多少佛就可以见到多少佛，见多百千佛，那就是能够见到更多的佛，乃至见多百千亿那由他佛，这是一个更大数字的佛。这个那由他呢，是一个梵文叫做无央数，中文叫做这个数目是很大的，几乎是很难算计出来。那么意思这个菩萨呢，他要见多少佛，那是很随意自在的。为什么菩萨可以见到这么多的佛呢？因为过去生中菩萨发了愿力，他要见佛。那这个见佛呢，对我们这种佛教徒来讲是非常重要的，一定要发这个愿。如果呢不能见佛呢，那我们想要修行有成就，这是非常困难的。
So here, when the bodhisattva dwells upon this, the ground of difficult conquest. So here the Bodhisattva is on the fifth ground, and his power and his vows are extremely solid. Here, through the power of his vows, he comes to see many Buddhas. So the Bodhisattva sees in the text hundreds of Buddhas. Maybe he sees hundreds, 200, 300, 800, 900. Then he sees thousands of Buddhas, maybe 2,000, 3,000, 8,000, 9,000. You can see the Bodhisattva is extremely effortlessly at ease. He's very peaceful. He can see as many Buddhas as he wishes. He can see all these Buddhas, up to hundreds of thousands of Buddhas, up to hundreds of thousands of kotis of nayutas of Buddhas. This word nayuta is a Sanskrit word. In Chinese, it's translated as wu yang su, a number that's very hard to calculate. It's a very, very big number. So why is the Bodhisattva able to see all these Buddhas? It's because the Bodhisattva in the past has made vows to see the Buddha. This is very important. As cultivators of the way, wishing to cultivate the Bodhisattva path, to see the Buddha is very important. If we do not make vows and we do not see the Buddha, it's very hard to walk the Bodhisattva path and have some true success.
如果不能见佛, 那就称为八难, 有八种难呢, 是不能见佛的。 哪八种难呢? 第一种难是, 在地狱, 那第二个是恶鬼, 第三是, 畜生, 就是在三恶道的众生呢, 他们不能见到佛。 还有一种就是叫盲聋喑哑, 出生以后呢, 他眼睛瞎了, 或是他是一个聋子, 听不到声音的。 那或是嘴巴不能讲话的，或是这种喉咙声音有问题的，那这样的人呢，因为过去生中他毁谤佛、毁谤法、毁谤僧，所以呢，他现在做人以后呢，六根不俱全，那他也不能见佛。
So if we can't see the Buddhas, that's a obstruction or an obstacle, a difficulty. There's a list in Buddhism called the eight difficulties, the eight obstacles. And in it, it's, for instance, not being able to see the Buddhas is one of them. Being in the hells is, so if there's list the eight, one is being in the hells, the other is being in the hungry ghost realms, the other is being an animal. And so all these three, instead of three lower destinies, these three paths of suffering, they can't see the Buddha. And then the fourth difficulty is that they're born in this world, but they're blind, deaf, or mute, or have their sixth sense organs aren't complete. Their sixth sense organs have problems. And so also for them, they can't see the Buddha. And for how do they have this happen? Well, in the past, they slandered the three jewels. They slandered the Buddha or the Dharma or the Sangha. And so a result from that action often is not having complete in one sense organs.
或是出生在北俱卢州的人，他也不能见佛。这个北俱卢州呢，是在我们四大部洲里头呢，须弥山旁边有四大部洲，在北方呢有一个叫北俱卢州。 那北俱卢州呢，它的福报很大，寿命呢有1000岁，比我们这个娑婆世界的众生呢生活好得很多。那因为福报大，那个福啊，所以呢那边的人呢就修福，所以他也不能见到佛，那边呢没有佛法，所以呢是一种难啊，这是一种恶难。另外呢是叫长寿天，这个长寿天呢又称为无想天，在色界的第四禅天里面。 他们有这种很高的禅定功夫，已经修到四禅了，但是为什么不见佛呢？因为他们修的是一种外道法，那所以这样的修行呢，已经走岔了，因此它也是一种难。另外呢是叫佛前佛后，如果呢这个佛还没有出世，那我们就出生了，就死了，那这时候见不到佛，这就是一种难。那现在释迦牟尼佛呢？ 在3000多年前，在印度成佛，那已经示现涅槃了。我们呢，在佛入涅槃以后呢，才出生在娑婆世界，那就叫做佛祸啊，就在佛的后面出生，这也是一种难。 所以在巴难里头呢就见不到佛。因此呢、这个既然见不到佛呢，以后就不能得到这个佛的受记，因为我们要成佛必须呢佛给我们受记，说你在多久以后呢你会成佛，那你成佛以后你的佛号叫什么，你的世界是怎么样的你的国度是怎么样，你的正法住是多久，你的相法住是多久，那末法又是多久，你所教化的众生又是怎么样，那佛会给我们受记。如果我们不能见到佛，不能得到佛的受记，那我们将来怎么可能成佛呢？因此呢一定要发愿成佛。
So the fifth difficulty in seeing the Buddha is being born in Uttaraku, which is in this world system around the mountain Mount Sumeru. We're in the southern world, or the southern land, the continent. And there's another continent, which is the Uttaraku, where the living beings there do not have a chance to see the Buddha. They have very blessed lives. Their lifespans are 1,000 years. They're full of blessings. However, there isn't any Dharma. And so that's considered a difficulty because they can't see the Buddha there. The sixth difficulty is that of, it's called the heaven of longevity or long life. Or it's also called the heaven of no thought. It's considered one of the states of the fourth dhyana. So if one cultivates the fourth dhyana, one can, a particular aspect of it, one can go to that heaven. But that particular method is, you could say, seeking outside. It's not in accord with the Buddha Dharma. It's a kind of going externally to get to this heaven. And so being in that heaven, one also, although very happy and very blissful, also can't see the Buddha there. The seventh is being born before the Buddha, and the eighth is being born after the Buddha. So for us, now, the Buddha was around 3,000 years before us, before we were born. Shakyamuni Buddha was born in India and already has entered Nirvana. And so for us, we're part of the eighth difficulty, that of being born after the Buddha. So if we are in the world, or if living beings are in the world when the Buddha is not there, and they don't meet the Buddha, then you cannot receive the Buddha's prediction. You can say the Buddha's certification or a prediction saying you will become a Buddha at such and such time, in such and such age, with such and such a name, with this this, and you have this kind of Buddha land, and these are the kind of living beings you'll be taught there. And not just that, it will say the length of your proper Dharma age, the length of the Dharma image age, the length of the Dharma ending age during that time. And so the Buddha then explains this to give a prediction for one to become a Buddha. And this is essential for one on the path to becoming a Buddha. So seeing the Buddha is extremely important.
除了发愿呢，要见佛之外，同时呢，我们也可以求生西方极乐世界去见佛。因为在末法中呢，这个修行很困难的，所以呢，佛就以他的慈悲心来讲这个净度法门。因此在经典上就讲说呢，在末法中呢，这个一亿人修行罕一得道，那么我以念佛得度，就是在这个末法的时候呢，很多人在修行，可是呢，能够得到的，能够这种开悟。明心见性，或是呢能够成就菩萨道，能够成佛的人实在少之又少，很少很少。那因此呢，佛就教导我们说，我们应该要念佛那才能够得度。意思说呢，如果我们念南无阿弥陀佛，求生西方极乐世界，那么这个时候呢，我们临命终的时候，佛就会来接引我们到极乐世界去。到极乐世界去以后呢，是不是这种在娑婆世界由这种父母父精母血 来组成我们的身体的，而是莲花化身到极乐世界呢？我们会在莲花里头，同时呢，虽然我们在娑婆世界这个所造的恶业还没有了，但是呢，因为乘着这种信愿行这种三资粮的愿力呢，可以待业往生， 就是呢，我们造了很多恶业，但是呢，还没有受果报之前，我们就可以呢，带着这个业到西方极乐世界，在莲花中，然后呢，等到花开以后就见佛了。花开见佛会怎么样呢？悟无生，就可以证到无生法忍。在佛教呢，讲这个证无生呢，是也是一个很高的境界。这个证无生呢，就到一种不退转的果位了。就是说，如果我们在修行呢，常常会怎么样？会生一种退转心啊，修行的又觉得这个菩萨道或是修行太难了，所以呢，有些人 跑到外道去，有些人呢就不修行了啊，或是懒惰、懈怠、放逸啊，在造作种种的恶业退转。可是如果我们修行到这种啊无生法忍的果位的时候，就是那个是其实呢已经是到八地菩萨以上。因此在华严经呢，就讲到这个七地菩萨，如果他证无生法忍了，马上就证到第八地不动地。不动地就是不退转啊，所以你在这个菩萨道就只能只会往前进，不会再往后退，那就是决定会成佛了。
So for us, there's also a teaching of the Pure Land, the Amitabha Pure Land tradition.And there, one can also see the Buddha. The Buddha Shakyamuni spoke about the teachings of the Pure Land of Amitabha Buddha to teach us living beings here in the Dharma ending age, saying that this particular method is most appropriate for us. Because in our time, in the Dharma ending age, there's a saying, many people cultivate the way, but those who truly awaken to the way are very few.But many people cultivate the Amitabha's Pure Land, and many people can be successful. And so, for us, reciting the Buddha's name is extremely valuable and appropriate one for us to be able to cultivate. By reciting Amitabha Buddha's name, we can then, and seeking rebirth in the Pure Land, then at the end of life, Amitabha Buddha comes and receives us and takes us to the Pure Land. And there, we will be reborn.From a lotus flower. It won't be like being reborn in this world where we come through a womb. Rather, we'll be transformationally born from a lotus flower. And not just that, when we go to this place, the karma that we've created, all the harmful actions, all the various deeds we have done, we will carry along with us to this land. And based on our faith, our vows, and our practice,the three essential elements of the Pure Land practice is faith, vows, and practice. We take this karma we have with us and we can take care of that karma there in the Pure Land. So over time, this flower opens, the lotus flower opens, and we see the Buddha. And upon seeing the Buddha, we realize the unconditioned, and we see the, we can also see the unproduced.The non-arising of dharmas. And we realize that stage, we become non-retreating, or basically we do no longer retreat from cultivation, and we just move forward, we just advance, we don't retreat. And this is important because for us, or for many people, when we start cultivating the way, oftentimes we want to give up, we want to retreat.We might think, oh, this is just too difficult. And so some people, they start going on in, they start seeking outside for some special method, or they look outside for some answers. Or they might just get lazy, or they just simply give up because they just find it too difficult. Well, for this particular bodhisattva, or when you're in the Pure Land, when you realize the eighth ground, you no longer retreat, you only advance. In the Avatamsaka Sutra, it talks about the seventh ground bodhisattva,that when they realize the unproduced, they immediately attain the eighth ground of the bodhisattva. And in the eighth ground, it's also called the ground of unmoving, the unmoving ground. And so then, the bodhisattva only goes forward in his cultivation. And for sure, he'll realize Buddhahood.
这三不退呢，不退转有三不退。第一个叫恨不退。他所修行的这种恨门法门呢，是不会退转，就是说这个菩萨他修行什么法门，他就一直以这个法门来修行，不会说看到另外一个法门的时候呢，他就 这个见异思迁、啊、或是喜新厌旧，他还是会照这个法门来修行，直到呢他修行成就了。第二个是叫做位不退，如果他修行呢证得的一个果位了，比如说菩萨呢证得这个、啊、像现在是第五地的菩萨，他就不会退转到第四地，如果他又证得第六地，他就不会退回到第五地，所以这个叫这个位不退，所证得的果位不会退转。那第三个叫念不退，这个菩萨呢在每个念头当中念念当中他都不退转，就是他的菩提心也不退转，他修行的恨门也不退转，那么他来帮助众生这种念头也不退转。因为在我们每个人这个心里头呢，这个念头呢是很维系的，非常的维系，这个念头呢啊会引导着我们呢啊去造作种种的这个善恶业。所以如果我们的每个念头都是正念，比如说我们要修行，我们要帮助众生，那这样的念头就是在行菩萨道，他不会退转到说去造作种种这种恶业的时候呢，那他修行呢就不会退转。所以菩萨在每个念头当中他是都不退转的，但是这个念头呢其实是很维系的。所以以前我讲过，这个每个念头里头呢有九十个刹那，就是如果你再把它分析，这么、啊、一刹那一弹指的念头里头有九十个刹那，然后呢在九这个每一个刹那里头还有九百个生昧，所以意思说在一个念头当中其实是有八万一千个生昧，有八万一千个生死在里头。可是呢菩萨在这么维系的念头里头，他每个这种念头都是不会退转。
So there's three, you say three types of not retreating. The first is that of practice. The bodhisattva who has this ability to not retreat in practice will be able to study any dharma method and never retreat and not retreat. He'll only go forward. He won't see another method and go, oh, I want to use that method or use change this to that. He'll stick to his method and not retreat and he'll come to success. Come to some success. The second is that of the not retreating in position. This means that any stage of realization he realizes or she realizes, then they will not go backwards. They will not go to another ground. For instance, this bodhisattva on the fifth ground, if they're not retreating in position, will not go back to the fourth ground, will not retreat. Or if the bodhisattva realizes the sixth ground, then he won't go back to the fifth ground, and so forth. The realized stage does not go backwards. The third type of not retreating is that of the thoughts. So each thought the bodhisattva has is proper, is in accord with the bodhi resolve. He does not retreat from his bodhi resolve in every single thought, moment to moment, every thought. Every thought is about helping living beings, is proper and in accord with the Dharma. Even his very, very, very subtle thoughts. Because our thoughts lead us to do all sorts of deeds, be they good or bad. And so if we have good thoughts or bad thoughts, they lead us to do good or bad, create good or bad karma. So the bodhisattva is only having proper thoughts to cultivate the way and help living beings, and not creating evil thoughts or harmful thoughts to create bad karma. So I've spoken about this before, but our thoughts can be extremely subtle. A thought of a finger snap, just a brief thought, actually has 90 kshanas in it. If you were to break it down, there's 90 moments of kshana, called kshanas, in each thought. And then even in that each kshana, there's 900 births and deaths, or you could say things that go, that get created and disappear in each kshana. So in each of these thoughts, there's 81,000 births and deaths, 81,000 things going on. And so for the bodhisattva, in every single of these 81,000 births and deaths, he is not retreating. He's going on the proper path.
另外呢还有一个见佛的方法，就是要让我们的六根清净。在《法华经》里头就讲到说，如果依照《法华经》修行呢，可以得到六根清净。这个六根就是我们的眼根、耳根、鼻根、舌根，还有身根、意根。这六根清净以后呢，它会有六千的功德来庄严我们的六根。 那我们六根一清净怎么样？这眼根一清净的，就可以用我们父母所生的这个肉眼，可以见到天上，可以见到人间，可以见到地狱，也可以见十方佛，或是诸佛呢在讲经说法的法会，这个得到眼根清净的众生，都可以用父母所生的这个肉眼可以看得到。即使呢他没有开天眼，那么一样可以见佛。
So, there's another way that we could see the Buddhas, and that is to be able to purify our six sense organs. According to the Lotus Sutra, it says that if we can purify our six senses, then we can see the Buddhas. So, the six sense organs are the eyes, ears, nose, tongue, body, and mind. And so by purifying them, the sutra says that once the six sense organs are purified, there's 6,000 merits that accrue to them. So that even the eye that we are born with, that our mothers gave birth to us, and so we have this physical body with eyes on it, you could say it's our physical eye, that eye can actually purify it, can see the heavens, can see our human realms, can even see through the hells. I can look throughout the 10 directions and see all the Buddhas in the 10 directions. And so just with this eye, this physical eye our mother gave birth to us, purified, we can see the Buddhas of the 10 directions. We don't need to attain the heavenly eye before we can do that. We can see with our physical eye.
在修行上呢，有一种法门叫忏悔。这个忏悔呢，有时候有一种忏叫取向忏。取向忏就是一个人他真心忏悔，比如说他在佛前礼佛，或是呢诵经，或是诵戒，那他这样很诚心的七天、十四天、二十一天，或是一个月、三个月、一年、三年不断的忏悔。那么要忏到怎么样呢？忏到他能够见到光、见到花、见到佛，或是见到佛给他摩顶了。这个时候他所造的这种罪业就可以呢灭了。就是表示呢，因为他诚心忏悔，可以呢因为这样的一个诚心，他罪业消灭以后呢，他能够见到佛。所以呢，这种在修行上来忏除自己的罪障、业障呢，也是见佛的一个方法。
So there's another method to cultivate to see the Buddhas, and that is through the Dharma door of repentance. So in the Brahmanet Sutra, it talks about repentance, and if one truly is sincere in repenting, one will see an auspicious sign to mark one's sincerity and a purity, purifying one's karma. So one can bow, recite the sutras and precepts, and be very sincere in repenting. And some people do it for 7 days, 14 days, 21 days, 1 month, 3 months, a whole year, 3 years, to the point that they will see a sign, that of light, maybe flowers, maybe the Buddha, or maybe the Buddha coming to rub their crown. This is shows their sincerity, and that the Buddha comes and blesses them, and marks that they're able to truly repent of their bad karma, and purify themselves. This is another way to see the Buddha.
那菩萨呢，对所有的佛都是恭敬尊重的。因为呢，菩萨心生恭敬，所以呢，他对佛呢就能够五体投地了。那如果我们对佛或是对所有的众生也能够生恭敬心、尊重心，那这样的人他就不会贡高我慢。他呢就可以折服这种我慢床，对别人呢都是客客气气的。那这个修行上，我们的心才能够调伏，因为我们的心呢，如果不柔软，我们的心太刚强了，那常常就会跟别人起对待，有冲突或是继续呢造作种种恶业，那就是因为我们的没有恭敬心，对别人呢不尊重。那么菩萨呢也要诚实供养这个十方的佛。那怎么诚实供养佛呢？供养佛的方法很多，但是在一般日常生活中，这种资生之具就是一种生活的用品上，有四种事情四事呢是供养的，就是衣服、饮食、卧具、汤药。 这个不但可以用世事来供养佛，同时呢，也可以用这个衣服、饮食、卧具、汤药来供养这种出家人。
So for the bodhisattvas, they all, the bodhisattva worships and reveres them, attends upon and makes offering to them all. So the bodhisattva here is extremely respectful and is extremely reverent towards the Buddhas. The bodhisattvas are, you could say they're all their limbs are on the floor, paying their respect to the Buddha, their heads lowered to pay respect to the Buddha, and they truly respect the Buddhas. So toward all Buddhas, all living beings, they're extremely polite and well-mannered. And so for us as well, we can follow and be like that and be like and follow in accord with the Bodhisattva's practices. And if our hearts are soft and flexible, does not look down upon anyone, but is respectful towards all, then naturally we will have good relationships and a good connection with other living beings. But if our mind is very hard, if we're very stubborn, and we can give rise to pride and arrogance, and that becomes very difficult. Oftentimes our difficulties with other people comes from because we truly don't respect other people. So important is to cultivate this sense of respect and reverence towards the Buddhas as well as all living beings. Now the next one is making offerings to the Buddhas. So there's many types of offerings that one can, many things that one can offer the Buddhas, but usually they point to the four necessities or four requisites. And what are the four requisites? Well, they're listed here as clothing, food and drink, bedding, and medicines. These are the necessities of life, and so he offers these to the Buddhas. Not just this, the people can make offerings of clothing, food and drink, bedding and medicines to the Sangha.
用这衣服、饮食、卧具、汤药，事事来供养三宝，就是佛法僧。那这是一种修福。但是呢，如果光修福呢，不修慧，其实也是很危险的，因为呢，福报很大，那将来得的这种福呢很多，可能就会容易堕落。因此呢，修福的同时要修慧啊，就是福慧要双修。因此啊，佛教徒要怎么样呢？一定要在听经闻法、研究经典。除了护持道场、用世事供养之外呢，也要能够啊来听闻佛法。那这样的话就是福慧双修。福慧双修呢，以后呢啊，才不会说你光修福不修慧。在有一首偈颂是这样讲的，说啊，修福不修慧，那么这个大象呢啊，这种修慧不修福啊，罗汉脱空波，就是说如果你只是修这个智慧，但是你不修福报，将来呢，即使你证得这个阿罗汉果呢，可是你去脱波乞食的时候呢，就没有人供养，因为呢，在过去生中没有这个修福，所以呢，只得到这个智慧，证得阿罗汉果。
So, one can make offerings to the triple jewel, to the three jewels, and by doing such offerings, one cultivates blessings. Now, as Buddhist disciples, we do not only want to cultivate blessings; we want to also cultivate wisdom and develop in our wisdom. Only cultivating blessings can be very dangerous because one can have a lot of blessings, but one day one will lose them. One will use it up, and you could say fall. One will descend to another realm or undergo difficulties. So as Buddha's disciples, we want to also learn wisdom as we cultivate blessings. A Buddha disciple, well, how do we do this? Well, we can listen to the sutras, study the Dharma, draw near the Dharma, and learn it. And this is a way for us to learn, have develop wisdom. So it's not just helping out at the monastery and doing work and service in the monastery that only gives us blessings. We only develop blessings. We must develop wisdom as well. There is a saying about this, saying that one only cultivates blessings and doesn't cultivate wisdom. That one is like an elephant with a ring of pearls around one's neck. And if one only cultivates wisdom and does not have blessings, then it's like an arhat with an empty alms bowl. So all the arhat has cultivated to become an arhat, though, however, when he goes out for alms round, no one makes offerings because he has not cultivated any blessings.
可是如果光修福不修慧呢，就像大象挂璎珞啊，为什么？那个象呢是属于畜生道的众生，那么大象呢，它呢没有智慧了，因为在畜生道里头。可是呢，它身上挂了很多璎珞，这个璎珞是一种庄严具，挂在身上呢，啊，庄严的很漂亮。那因为过去生中呢，它修福，所以有这个福报，但是呢，没有这个智慧，所以。一个真正的这种佛教徒呢，他一定要修福修慧。那么在家人呢，啊，这个最大的这种修福的对象就是三宝，因为呢，这个佛呢是世间最大的福田。那么出家人呢，虽然是一个凡夫生，但是他代表三宝来接受供养，让众生能够持福，那么他们以后就会有这个福报。因此，出家人守穿的这个袈裟是一个表法，像现在呢，我们穿这个袈裟，你可以看到啊，我们两个现在穿的叫七衣啊，就是七条割结成的衣服，然后有这种横结啊，一块一块的，像就是像田一样。所以呢，啊，一般的这个出家人就称为福田僧。所谓福田僧，就是让在家人来种福田的啊，一个出家人，他是代表三宝的。那么虽然呢，这个啊，福田僧呢还没有开悟，还没有证果，但是呢，他呢是一个表法，就是来代表三宝的。所以有一句话说呢，啊，这个泥龙虽不能降雨，但祈福必假泥龙。就是说这个，如果你要去祈雨，像现在加州干旱了，那不下雨了。那你怎么办呢？要祈雨的时候呢，要假借这个泥龙啊，就是用泥土来雕塑的龙来祈啊，就是祈求呢这个龙呢能够兴云下雨。那以前上人呢在加州缺水的时候，也曾经举办过这个啊祈雨的法会。那所以呢，那个如果你要祈福怎么办呢？啊，凡夫虽不能降福，就是一个凡夫生，他也没有很大的神通，不能啊给这个众生福报。但是呢，祈福不必假凡生，你要祈求这种将来有福报，必须呢啊透过这个凡夫生。所以你供养这个三宝，就不要起分别，说哪个出家人是有修行啊，那我供养他多一点；哪个出家人呢没有正果，那他不值得供养，或是我就供养少少的，啊，这个供养的时候不能有分别心，因为呢，所有的出家人他披了袈裟以后，就是一个表法，就是代表三宝来接受众生的供养。如果啊，这个在家人供养三宝以后呢，那么以后他一定会有这个大福报的。那么现在你看到很多人贫穷困苦，就是因为过去生中他没有供养三宝，或是呢他对这个穷苦的人啊悭贪啊吝啬，不肯的布施，所以呢才会得到贫穷的果报。
So the other one, which is the elephant with a ring of a necklace of pearls around his neck, you could say represents cultivating blessing without any wisdom. The elephant is in the realm of the animals, and so in the animal realm, oftentimes they don't have very much wisdom. But however, this elephant, he has a necklace of pearls, of beautiful pearls around his neck, and you could say these are adornments. These are things that come from his many have come cultivating blessings. So he has this necklace of pearls, but he doesn't have the wisdom. So as Buddhist disciples, we want to cultivate both blessings and wisdom. And how do we do that? Well, first, to cultivate blessings, making offerings to the triple jewel, the three jewels, is the best method. The Buddha is the foremost field of offerings. And so being able to make offerings to the Buddha is the most profound way to plant blessings. The Sangha is another representation of the three jewels, And the Sangha, although it's an ordinary Sangha, that means that the Sangha member or the monastic has not realized the way. However, the Sangha, or an ordinary monastic, still represents the three jewels. The left home, the monastics, have on the sash, for instance, the two monks here have their sash. On the sash is a symbol, is a representation of the field of blessings, how the Sangha is a field of blessings. Namely, the sashes we're wearing right now are a seven-piece sash. Basically, there's seven lines, vertical lines on the sash, and there's horizontal lines that crisscross them, making a shape which is like a square with a cross in the middle, which is a, you could say, represents paddy fields, rice fields. And so it represents how the monastics are fields of blessings. They represent the three jewels. So although they are not awakened, they don't have any, you could say, real spiritual abilities, they're still a symbolic representation of the three jewels. So there's another saying: if one wishes to seek rain, what do you do? Well, you can make a, you can sculpt an image of a dragon out of clay. And so if you want to seek blessings, what do? You can make offerings to that of the, from the ordinary Sangha, from the, to the Sangha. And so basically, if one wants rain, just like there's now a drought in California, one, you can say, sculpts an image of a dragon out of clay and mud. And in the past, the Venerable Master actually had a Dharma assembly seeking rain, hoping to help end the drought. Now, for those living beings who wish to make offerings, one makes offerings to the Sangha. And although one makes offerings to a Sangha member who does not have any real true spiritual ability, no spiritual powers, or is able to, is not awakened. However, one has to go through them to be able to plant blessings. So when one makes offerings, one should not have any discrimination about this Sangha member, this monastic has a lot of cultivation, and that Sangha member doesn't have any cultivation. You know, this monastic is this way, or that monastic is that way. Rather, the monastics, when they put on the sash, they're representation of the three jewels. And so one makes offerings, the lay people make offerings without discrimination. And so this is seen as a way to create great blessings. So if you look at living beings, there are some people who are extremely impoverished, who live in great poverty. This comes from in the past, they did not make offerings to the three jewels. Also, in their lives in the past, they might have been stingy, extremely stingy, and not sharing any of their things and not being generous in any way. So now they have to undergo the result of being impoverished.
最近两个月呢，我遇到一个真心来供养三宝的一个实际的例子。那我可以跟大家来分享这个故事。在两个月前呢，就是有一个老太太，她告诉我说呢，在两年前，那么她到万佛圣城去拜万佛宝忏。那时候因为在四五月间拜万佛宝忏，那佛殿人很多，空气呢不流通，同时呢有时候早上天气很凉快，那下午又有点热，那所以呢很多人都生病了。因为在佛殿那么一个空间有大概有300个人左右在拜忏，所以呢很多人都生病，一生病呢就互相传染。那 很多人呢，比如说他就发烧啦，或是咳嗽啊，或是呢拜得很辛苦。这个老太太呢，她看了呢，觉得心里呢很难过。她说呢，这些呢这么多人，那很多人从国外来，很多或是从别的地方来，他们到万佛圣城呢来拜忏，那修行呢很辛苦的。可是他们生病了，这拜起忏来更辛苦。同时也有很多出家人生病，因此呢，她就发慈悲心。她说呢，我应该帮助这些人呢。能够在生病的时候得到好的这种照顾，因此呢，他回去以后， 就捐了一笔很大的钱啊，这钱不算小，那就希望呢能够在这种医疗上啊，帮助出家人啊，或是说啊来万佛圣城，当他们有困难的人，也可以呢得到这样的一个帮助，就这样的真心来供养三宝。那老太太呢，她的子女都很孝顺啊，那个因为她年纪大了，那么跟她的女儿住在一起。平常呢就到我们的这个道场去跟大家一起修行，那因为他懂得佛法了，知道说要供养三宝，要做布施，那这样的话才能够呢啊真正来这个修福，同时呢也让自己的生命更有意义。因此呢，老太太呢在做完这件事情以后呢，她心里非常的高兴。那么到一个月前呢，他又完成他另外一件的心愿。那他就想呢，啊，说上人呢，他创办了万佛圣城这样一个好的道场，那么同时呢，也来弘扬佛法，创办教育，啊，因此呢，他希望帮助上人呢，能够把这个教育办得更好。因此呢，他希望把他这个啊这一生最后所有的积蓄呢，全部捐出来给这个学校。让上人的这种教育呢能够扎这个根扎得更深。那因此呢就我们就开始呢来进行这样的一个事情。
So I just want to share a true story with everyone that I learned 2 months ago, that I could feel that is a really, you could say, sincere example of making offerings.There's an elder lady who said about 2 years ago, came for the 10,000 Buddhas repentance at the City of 10,000 Buddhas. Usually that's in April and May. And so, if people have come to bow the 10,000 Buddhas repentance, everyone is in the Buddha hall. And in the Buddha hall, the ventilation isn't the best. And so, the weather patterns also changes a lot. Can be hot, can be very cold, inside and outside.And so many people get sick during this time. So a lot of people get together into the hall to bow the repentance. And because of everybody's together and it's not that great ventilation, people can get sick. And oftentimes it's very, the illness is contagious. So a lot of people have fevers or cough. So this older lady felt very bad about this situation.Especially seeing so many overseas Dharma cultivators, fellow cultivators at the City of 10,000 Buddhas, they came all the way over and they have to go through a very difficult day working very hard, bowing the repentance. And also seeing the monastics as well getting sick, she really wished to have a way to help them. So what did she do after the bowing repentance? She actually went back and donated quite a bit of funds to help, particularly to help with the care of people who are sick, both the monastics as well as the lay people, and who have difficulties or go through some sickness during these Dharma assemblies. So this, you can also say this was not just a little bit of money, she gave quite a bit. So this elder lady also has children who are actually quite filial. And so she goes with her children to...and a branch monastery to cultivate and practice on a regular basis. There she's able to plant blessings, and by going to the monastery and planting blessings and making offerings, one lives a very happy life and lives a very meaningful life. So she was very happy with her offering, and so 1 month ago, she was able to also complete another wish, one of her vows, her wishes,which is that she really believes in the education that the Venerable Master set up. She wishes to really support that. And so what she did was that she wanted to give all her possessions to support the Venerable Master's vow of education, to support education, improve education for the better. So she was able to also do that.
这个老太太她跟我讲说呢，她现在年纪大了，那她的子女呢都很孝顺她，那她每天呢也生活得很快乐，那也不需要花很多钱， 所以呢他不需要身边留什么钱，因此他愿意把这个钱呢全部啊就是捐给学校。那因为这个钱呢在海外，所以呢啊就是经过他一个在中国的女儿帮忙，那就把这个钱汇到我们的学校里面来。因此呢在这整个汇款过程当中，他的女儿呢啊就写了信跟我讲说呢，老太太呢因为啊这是他这一生当中一个心愿，也可以讲是很大的一个心愿，就是要来护持上人啊，护持上人的道场之外，同时呢要护持上人所创办的教育。因此呢他的女儿说，当我们在进行这个汇款过程当中，每一个小小的这种讯息呢对老太太来讲都是非常重要，因为呢让她很欢喜，她觉得呢啊她的心愿快圆满了，所以她很喜欢听到这些讯息。等到把这个事情做完了，然后呢老太太很高兴，我跟她讲电话的时候呢她真的是非常的高兴。然后她的女儿说呢，这是她母亲呢啊这个80岁生日快到了，一个最大的礼物，你看这是布施呢供养啊，这么快乐这么幸福，他把这个心愿完成了，他好像得到解脱了。所以呢这个真正呢啊能够会功就是会修福的人，就是呢把这个啊自己的这种钱财啊或是财物能够来供养三宝，让三宝呢来啊为这个众生呢做更多的事情，这是最有意义的。所以我自己就想一想，为什么这个老太太这么有福报，她年纪大了也不愁吃不愁穿，然后呢子女呢都扶持她，甚至呢愿意帮助她来完成她的心愿。因为老太太在要做这件事情之前呢曾经问过她的子女说，我这些钱呢要去啊来供养三宝，要去来捐给学校，那你们会不会反对啊？那子女呢没有一个反对，他们都愿意来帮助他完成心愿，因为他的子女也都是非常虔诚的佛教徒，所以他们知道这种啊怎么来修福修慧，什么是真正的因果。所以我相信呢这老太太呢啊因为修福啊，那即使他这个来生呢一定还有更大的福报，因为呢这个在地藏经讲叫做舍一得万报。我们呢能够真心的供养或是布施帮助别人的时候，你呢舍了 一块钱、啊、将来得到的福报是以万计算的，所以呢这样才是真正的在修福。
So this elder lady is very happy when she made the offering to the triple jewel to the schools to support Venerable Master's education. She had very filial children as wellAnd so she said, you know, when she was talking to me, that she has very filial children. She's very happy. And she doesn't need very much money. What does she need to buy? Everything is more or less taken care of. So she wanted to give everything she had to really support the Venerable Master's triple jewel and also to support education, the Venerable Master's educational efforts. So her funds are actually overseas. And so her daughter...was going through the various steps to be able to transfer the money to the schools. And so she was it was interesting because every step of this process, her daughter was told us that she would let her mother know, and her mom would be very happy because she always feel like, oh, my vow is almost complete. I'm almost, you know, I'm almost able to fulfill the vow that I made.That to really protect the triple jewel and to support education. And so she really had this in her heart to want to complete this vow, and she was very happy doing it. And her daughter said that her mother's 80th birthday is almost here. And so this is kind of like her 80th birthday present. Now you can just see, wow, this elder lady is extremely blessed.She's really just being able to make this kind of fulfill this kind of wish of hers was like a great joy in her life, almost like she's been liberated. She's been very, very happy. So you can see somebody who truly knows how to make offerings, how great their blessings are. They're able to give everything away, and especially giving to the triple jewel, which would then be used to truly help living beings. That's There's quite a lot of blessings being planted. So I thought, you know, why is this lady full of blessings? Why is it that she lacks nothing? She doesn't lack anything. She's not lacking in clothing or food. And her children are all extremely filial. They really take care of her. And for instance, when she told all the children, okay, I'm going to make an offer, all my money and all of everything I have to the Triple Jewel and to education. And if any of you have any, you can say, concerns about this, any of you don't think this is a good idea, all her children all supported her in her decision, in her vow. They knew she made her vow and wanted to support her in it. So none of her children, you could say, were against it. Actually, all her children are also sincere Buddhist disciples as well, so they understand the principle of making offerings. So I'm sure that in this lady's next life, she'll be even more blessed. Because in the Earth Store Sutra, it says, by renouncing one, you're able to receive a result of 10,000. So being able to make an offering of just $1 in the future, one receives blessings of, you can say, $10,000.
于诸佛所恭敬听法，这个菩萨呢，他在诸佛这种道场法会里头呢，很恭敬的来听佛讲经说法。 那么讲这个听了以后呢，要依教奉行，所以呢，闻以受持，听闻了这个佛法以后呢，他就受之于心，持之于身。那么就是说，在身心上，他都依照佛所讲的这个经法来修行，随力修行，随自己的这种力量来修行自己的法门。
So in the presence of all those Buddhas, he reverently listens to the Dharma. Having heard it, he accepts and holds it, and according to his power, he cultivates. So now the Bodhisattva is able to hear the Dharma. He comes and learns the Dharma. And then when we learn the Dharma, we have to put it into practice. We have to accord with it. And so he cultivates with both his body and his mind. And he cultivates to the level that he's able, the strength that he has to cultivate the way.
这个听法呢，要很恭敬的，因为佛法是在恭敬中求，同时呢，听法也是一种永护道场。像现在在伯克莱圣寺有很多居士在这里听法，那同时呢，在网络上也有人在听法。这个听法呢，是很重要的。听法就像我们每天吃饭一样，那每天呢，我们肚子饿了要吃饭，因为我们的色身呢，如果没有吃饭， 会败坏，同时呢，也会没有力气，就不能做事情。可是呢，一般世俗的人他不知道呢，我们另外有一个法身，我们的法身呢，也需要这个法食来滋长它。然后呢，我们的法身慧命呢，滋长以后呢，我们就开始智慧，将来也能够证得法身，像佛一样。因此呢，听法是非常重要的。那么听法在佛法中呢，它称为一种叫文字波了。 文字波了就是你根据经典来读或是诵或是研究它，或是呢听法是讲法，用这种语言文字来学习佛法，那么就会得到一种智慧，叫做波了。这个叫文字波了。那透过文字波了，就表示我们的智慧已经开启了。可是这个时候还不够，还要进一步怎么样？要起观照波了。观照就是我们的六根眼耳鼻舌身意开始呢，不向外持求了，不会对这个外境色声香味触法所转了。就是说，当我们的六根对着六尘的时候呢，我们这个心是不动的，我们呢要回光返照来观自己的心。那这时候就能够起一种观照波了，这是修行的一种初步功夫了。
So being able to respectfully listen to the Dharma is extremely important, because the Dharma, one really can enter into the Dharma from having a sincere and respectful heart. So also by listening to the Dharma, one's able to, you say, protect the Dharma assembly, to protect the monastery. So those, everybody here is able to, you could say, protect the Dharma assembly, to protect the monastery. to support the monastery, and also those all listening online are doing the same. To be able to learn the Dharma, we must do it regularly, just like eating food. We eat food to maintain our physical body. It gives us energy, allows us to continue to function. But many of us, or many people, do not know that we also have a Dharma body. And this Dharma body needs the Dharma to continue to grow, for our wisdom to grow. So we must learn the Dharma every day. This is very important. In Buddhism, we talk about three types of prajna, or three types of wisdom. The first one is literary prajna. Literary prajna comes from reading, reciting the sutras, studying the Dharma, maybe listening to Dharma talks or sutra lectures. So we are able to learn the Dharma and understand it. So this is the beginning of having wisdom, the beginning of our wisdom. Now, the next step in this process is the second, which is contemplative prajna. And this corresponds to when our six sense organs no longer go outside, no longer get turned by external states. Rather, we take our six sense organs and use it to contemplate internally so that we're able to have a still and unmoving mind. This begins the process of developing contemplative wisdom.
这个听法呢, 除了学习佛法, 来修行之外, 同时呢, 也是来护持道场, 因为呢, 道场有这种, 啊, 四众弟子, 就是有出家人, 有在家人, 啊, 在一起研究, 所以呢, 这个道场就会兴盛, 因此呢, 如果你常常到道场来听法, 这就是在拥护道场, 那么拥护道场的同时呢, 其实也是跟所有与会的这些 大众来结法缘， 因为在过去生中 必然结过一种法缘， 所以呢， 现在又有机缘在一起来学习佛法。 那么， 其实呢， 在佛教是讲因果的， 如果呢， 你现在乐于听法， 那将来呢， 有一天， 你也成为一个出家人了， 或是成为一个法师， 你也来讲经说法， 那时候呢， 就会有人来听法了。 为什么呢？ 因为你过去生中好要听法， 有这个讲经的法会，你就会去听。那以后呢，你自己讲经说法，也就有人会来听法。这是一个因果。那如果我们不这样做呢？即使你很会讲经说法，或是呢，这个是一个很有名的法师，有时候那个法缘不足的时候呢，讲经说法可能呢也没有人来听法。
So this is also to come and listen to the Dharma as a way to protect and maintain the monastery. Because here in the monastery, when we do this, all the four assemblies gather together. You can see the four assemblies are the monks, nuns, laymen, laywomen. We all gather together to learn the Dharma together. And this allows the monastery to flourish, to really be a good place. And so when we all listen together, we also create Dharma affinities with one another. And because we're studying the Dharma together. And so it's only because we had Dharma affinities from the past that now we're able to gather together to learn the Dharma. So here's a cause and effect. Namely, we are extremely happy and joyful learning the Dharma. Then in the future, we might perhaps become a monastic. We might leave home. And we teach the Dharma, then others will come and listen, and they will want to listen and be very happy to do so, to learn from you to when you're explaining and teaching the sutras. This is because one has tied up Dharma affinities in the past. So this is the cause and effect. So you can see sometimes some people are very eloquent, they can really speak the Dharma, they may be very famous, but if their Dharma affinities aren't sufficient, then no one comes to learn the Dharma.
这个英光老法师呢，他是净土宗第十三代的祖师，也是大势至菩萨再来，所以是一个菩萨的这种示现。那么可是呢，他在讲法一般来讲，很多人是会来听法的，但是有时候法缘不足呢，或是跟某一个地方的众生，这种法缘不够，也会造成没有人来听法。所以有一次英光法师呢，到南京他去讲经。 可是呢，这个底下呢，居然 空空的，都没有人，只有一个人在那边听法。不过印光法师呢，他是一个菩萨，他觉得呢没有人听法也没有关系，只要有一个人啊，这个印光老法师还是很欢喜。那么等到这个讲法讲完了，老法师说，哎，你听我这个法听得怎么样啊？那这个人就说，哦，我不是来听法的，我呢是准备关门的啊，就是啊，没有人听，因为他是来这看这个场所的，所以呢，印光老法师呢，是因为这样子，他就知道自己在这个南京的法缘呢不好，可能过去生中没有跟这里的众生结缘，因此呢，这个啊，这个在修行过程中说呢，未成佛道要先结人缘，我们还没有成佛以前呢，要跟人家结善缘的。啊，这善缘呢，不是说你出家来才来结善缘，人与人之间呢，都要互相结好的缘，互相帮助。那这样的话，将来呢，都会有很好的缘分。你要修行的时候，就会遇到很多很好的同修道友。你在懒惰懈怠放逸的时候，就会有人来提醒你啊，或是你要堕落的时候，就有人来拉你一把。所以呢，这个啊，在修行过程中结善缘很重要。那也是说。你看啊，今天有这么多人来听法，那就是在互相结善缘。那以后呢，当你遇到困难的时候，你还会遇到这些好的啊，这种同修道友来帮助你。
So, for instance, Great Master Ying Guang, who was a 13th Pure Land Patriarch, who's also a transformation body of great strength Bodhisattva.He would speak to Dharma. He would lecture, and sometimes many people came, and sometimes very few people came. There was one time he was in Nanjing in China, and he was speaking on the sutras, and the whole hall was empty. Only one person showed up to listen to him speak. So it was like a very empty hall, and so he, as a Bodhisattva, you know, no difficulty, no problem.So if one person wants to learn, then there's one person. So he was very happy and explained the Dharma. Afterwards, he asked the person, so how was it when you learned Dharma? The person said, oh, I'm not here to learn the Dharma. I came here to watch the door. I have to lock up afterwards. So this one person was just there to take care of the ground so that they can lock up the hall afterwards. So he knew that because he hasn't tied up Dharma affinities with anybody in Nanjing, that he just didn't have the affinities with the people there.So for us, cultivating to realize Buddhahood, we want to cultivate good affinities. It's not just for monastics, but for all of us. We want to cultivate good affinities with all living beings. Then we will always be surrounded by good Dharma friends. And for instance, if we are cultivating away in one day, or we start getting lazy, or we start getting discouraged,then somebody will be there to remind us, to give us a little bit of a push, to help us out, to kind of exhort us. And if we are going to fall, we're going to kind of give up, then there's somebody to kind of pull us along, to give us a hand. And so, and for us now here, everybody together, if we have come to listen to the sutra lecture,then we're all tying up Dharma affinities with one another. So that when the time comes and we meet, say, some difficulty, then these beings around us, we could come and support us, will help us out. And it's because we tied up good Dharma affinities.
我们那个今天讲经就到这里，那不晓得有没有什么问题。
So we'll speak just in this time now. I don't know if there's any questions.
阿弥陀佛。请你有两个问题要问法师。A disciple want to ask the Dharma Master two questions. The first question is the Dharma Master 印光法师刚才提到印光老法师的故事。那老法师其实留下了一套的书信集《印光大师全集》。那所以我就想弟子的问题就是，是不是老法师其实他是用书信来跟众生讲经说法，而不是用 lecturing 的方式来说法？所以当我们说讲经说法的时候，是不是不是局限于只是用语言，他也可以用文字来对众生开示。然后第二个问题是，这个菩萨住南圣地，我们常讲说，一地菩萨不知道二地菩萨的境界， 那我在想说，当这个菩萨在发愿的时候，他说他见多佛、见百佛、千佛，那为什么他们没有发愿说我要见多菩萨、百菩萨、千菩萨，就是比他的能力更好一地的菩萨？就是两个问题。Did I translate my first question? Yeah. All right. My first question is regarding to the Yingguang, Dhamma Master Yingguang, because Dhamma Master Yingguang has a collection of letters, and that's his ways of, let's say it's Dhamma Master Yingguang's ways of speaking Dhamma. So my question is, do we have to define the speaking Dhamma by just... lecturing through the word, and or we can say speaking Dhamma also we can use by means of words, letters, or other means to spread the Dhamma or to tie the Dhamma affinity with the being. And the second question is, it was said that the first ground Bodhisattva won't be able to realize the second ground Bodhisattva's state. So I'm wondering why they don't make a vow to see more bodhisattva, like the bodhisattva understanding higher than their state. That question. Bad translation. Apologize for that.
好，我回答你第一个问题。刚刚我讲到文字波勒，其实文字波勒呢，除了写书或是书信，像英光法师跟很多。在家弟子用书信往来来教导他们佛法，或是呢他写一些著作来流传后世，那这也是一个弘扬佛法。那后世呢讲经说法，其实英光法师也在上海讲过经。那有一个女学生，因为要皈依了以后，以后的人才知道，原来英光老法师是大势至菩萨再来的。所以英光法师是同时用两个法门，就是他也现场讲经说法，同时他也著书立说，或是用种种书信来教导众生。其实他教导的也不是说只是当时的人，因为这些印光大师的文抄，那么三大部三本到现在我们还可以读，英光法师不住世了，他还在教化我们，所以一样可以弘扬佛法。那你再看看像以前那个天台的智者大师，他呢讲这个《法华经》，那《法华经》呢，我先让他翻译，免得讲太多。
So, for the first your first question about Great Master Yingguang, and that he wrote books and wrote many letters, to the people responding to their questions to teach them. And so, for in terms of teaching the Dharma. Or speaking the Dharma, there's many ways to do so. When I mentioned the literary prajna, that's through words. So he wrote letters to teach living beings, and he also wrote commentaries and responded to their Dharma questions. So this is one way that he could help living beings learn the Dharma. He also spoke sutras. For instance, in Shanghai, he would lecture on the sutras. And there, one of the disciples took refuge, found out that he was great strength bodhisattva, and so he used the two different ways to cult to you can say teach. He used the sutra lectures, and he also wrote. So he not just that, he wasn't just teaching the living beings of that time. He also was living beings later as well. For instance, we are included because his collected works are in three books, and we can still read it now. And his teachings can still teach us now. And so it's still able to, you could say, develop and propagate the Dharma. Great Master Zizza is the same. He is part of the Lotus, he also propagated the Lotus Sutra.
智者大师呢，他因为法华经而开悟，所以他演说法华经。那他讲法华经的时候在南京，那也在别的地方。那么可是呢，他只是用讲的，并没有写下来。他那时候有一个弟子叫张安尊者，那么他听法华经的时候是27岁，等到他69岁的时候呢，他就把它记录下来。你看了、听了42年呢，他可以把他这个所听过的法再记录下来，没有忘失掉，那么就结集成现在叫做法华玄义跟法华文句。 那我们后人呢，就对这两部这个法华文句、法华玄义呢，还是非常的就是非常相信，因为所有历代的祖师都相信这是智者大师所流传下来的法，是他的弟子结集下来的。所以你看这个智者大师他讲经，但是他的弟子再把他讲的法结集下来，也可以到利益到现在我们后世这种甚至几千几百几万年以后的众生都可以得利的。所以呢，这个讲经说法不只是说限定在这种只是用语言，它用文字一样有这种更长远的效果。那现在因为语言呢，我们可以透过录音，像上人以前所讲的这种开示经典，我们都可以听得到，因为有现在的科技，所以都是弘扬佛法的非常好的方法。
So, great master Zizhe cultivated the Lotus Sutra's methods of cultivation, and he was able to attain realization and wake up and get enlightened through this method. So he lectured on the Lotus Sutra. So in Nanjing, in China, he would speak on the Lotus Sutra, and one of his disciples, he didn't write, he only spoke, he did not write anything down. But his disciple, Venerable Zhang An, listened to him speak when he was 27 years old. Later, when he was 69 years old, he wrote down what Venerable Master Zizhe said. So you see, 42 years later, he still could remember what Great Master Zizhe said very clearly and be able to write it down, and became compiled into two books that are commentaries on the Lotus Sutra that are very well respected. Many people believe deeply in these two commentarial texts on the Lotus Sutra because many of the patriarchs, the great patriarchs, have pointed to it and said this represents the thought and teachings of Great Master Zizhe. So you can see that although Great Master Zizhe himself did not write it down, his disciples recorded it, and now we as beings much later, 100 years later, 1,000 years later, even 10,000 years later, can still benefit from these teachings because they're written down. So you cannot say that the Dharma can only be propagated or supported through the spoken word, through speech, but rather writing as well is definitely a way that the Dharma can be spread. Also now with modern technology, for instance, we have Venerable Master's tape lectures. Those are very helpful. As well as now we have this online broadcast and various technological tools to help us learn the Dharma.
那第二个问题说，为什么这个菩萨发愿要见这么多的佛，而不是发愿要见很多的菩萨？其实呢，这个问题可以从《法华经》呢得到答案的。在《法华经》讲说呢，第二品方便品。那方便品讲说呢，佛以前用声闻法、缘觉法、菩萨法这三乘法来教化众生，因为教众生有不同的根基，有这种声闻的根基，有缘觉的根基，有菩萨的根基。可是到法华会上，佛就讲说什么，在这个世界上唯有一乘法，无二亦无三，就是说在世界上只有一乘法。什么是一乘法呢？成佛的法，唯一唯一佛乘，就是只有一乘，成佛才是这种佛乘，没有三乘，没有声闻乘，没有缘觉乘，没有菩萨乘。因此呢，你要修行菩萨道，最终的目的就是成佛，不是成为菩萨。如果你成为菩萨，那还是在中道智化，不能继续，还是在一个化成的境界，就是说他只到中途，还没有到一个保守，没有到一个最究竟的佛果。所以那个不是菩萨修行的一个最终目标。
So your second question about why the Bodhisattva didn't make vows to see other Bodhisattvas. Now, I think you can look at the Lotus Sutra to find an answer to this question, especially in the chapter on the expedients. I think it's chapter 2. So in there, it talks about the three vehicles, how the Buddha taught three vehicles, or three ways of practice. And those three ways are, one is the sound hearer vehicle, the other is the Pracheka Buddha vehicle, the third is the Bodhisattva vehicle. These three different, you could say, modes of practice. And so, but in the Lotus Sutra, it says that actually all three of those vehicles are expedients. there's only truly one vehicle, and this one vehicle is the Buddha vehicle, that all beings to realize Buddhahood. There's not really these three vehicles. They were just spoken in expedience. So the Bodhisattva is cultivating the Bodhisattva path. He realizes, he seeks to see the Buddhas. He doesn't seek to see the Bodhisattvas. If you're trying to seek the Bodhisattva, see the Bodhisattvas, that's not ultimate. That's still within, you could say, the expedient Dharma. That's still within the transformation city. And so he wishes to see the ultimate, and that's really, that's the, you could say, the ultimate point, becoming a Buddha, not still in the expedient Dharma.
我再讲一个简短的故事来回答这个问题好了。这大家都知道，这个苏东坡跟佛印禅师呢是好朋友。那可是苏东坡呢，常常觉得在佛印禅师的面前很丢脸，因此他要找机会啊，要把这个面子呢给要回来。有一次他跟佛印禅师呢在对坐，那对坐完了，打坐完了，苏东坡就问佛印禅师说：“你看我像什么？”那佛印禅师说：“我看你像佛。”那佛印禅师就问苏东坡说：“那你看我像什么？”那佛印那个苏东坡就说：“哦，我看你像一堆牛粪。”那这个苏东坡呢，这自己觉得很得意，因为他觉得呢，佛印禅师说他是佛，那他觉得佛印禅师是一堆牛粪。他回家以后很高兴，就对他的妹妹讲这个事情。他的妹妹就跟苏东坡说：“啊，哥哥啊，你真的是。”太心量太小，你输得太惨了。因为呢，佛印禅师呢心中都是佛，所以他看每个人都是佛。你呢心中都是一堆牛粪，所以你看每个人都是牛粪。那我讲这个没有任何不好的意思，是说你这个菩萨呢心中有佛，所以他要见多这么多的佛。那如果你心量再小一点，你就要想见菩萨。你的心量再小一点，你就想为见那些缘觉声闻，因为你崇拜他嘛。所以你心中有他，可是现在菩萨心中唯有佛，那么所以他不，如果他成佛以后，他也不会分别这个声闻缘觉菩萨，因为声闻缘觉菩萨将来都可以成佛，众生都是平等的。
So let me tell you another short story about this. People know there's a famous poet in Chinese culture called Su Dong Po, and he had a you could say an acquaintance who was Chan Master Fo Ying, and so there's many stories between these two. Where the poet Su Dong Po would try to kind of get the upper hand on Great Master Fo Ying or Chan Master Fo Ying. He'd often kind of get in these little encounters, and he always kind of walk away embarrassed. So he always try to think of ways that he can get the upper hand, and kind of, you know, save face and be, you know, somehow the winner of their encounter. So one time they were sitting across from each other, and Su Dong Po asked the Chan Master Fo Ying, saying, "When you look at me, what do you see?" And Great Master Fo Ying says, "Well, I see the Buddha." And so then the Chan Master Fo Ying asks Su Dong Po, "So when you look at me, what do you see?" And Su Dong Po very happily said, "Well, I see you just like cow's excrement, an excrement from a cow." And then so Su Dong Po felt very proud when he left, feeling, "Yes, I really won that one. I really see, he sees me as a Buddha. I see him as a pile of cow's excrement." So he told this to his younger sisters. "You know, I just had an encounter and he saw me as the Buddha, and I saw him as cow's excrement." And his younger sister says, "Oh, your older brother, I'm sorry. I have to say, actually, you just really lost even more, because his heart is so so expansive that he sees everybody as Buddhas. But your mind is so narrow that you see everybody just cow's excrement." So for the Bodhisattva, his heart is to wish to see the Buddha, because he in his heart wants to see the Buddhas. And this shows that he's not trying to see the Bodhisattvas, because, or for instance, we wish to see the Pracheka Buddhas or the sound hearers, because this is what you could say, what we admire, what we strive to look for, what we strive to, what the kind of beings that we wish to emulate. And so no, the Bodhisattva here is wishing to see the Buddhas. Also here, the Bodhisattva, but when the Bodhisattva realized Buddhahood, then all three of those vehicles are actually only one vehicle. There's no discrimination.
法师您的回答让我联想到观音菩萨他已经成佛，他过去生是明法正如
正法明如来，
正法明如来，然后他成为菩萨的原因，是不是因为他可以借由菩萨身份更靠近众生？然后所以说英文翻译是 So we know that actually 观音 Bodhisattva was already the Buddha, but he manifests as a Bodhisattva. So the reason why he did that because he wanted to get closer to the living being and enable to cross them over. Is that the reason?
是的，因为观音菩萨呢，他道家慈航，示现菩萨身来度化众生，比较容易亲近接近众生。为什么呢？在佛经上讲，菩萨有两种，一种在家，在家菩萨名为比丘，出家菩萨就是你们出家啊、在家菩萨就是一般的出家人。那所以呢，在这个在家的菩萨呢，有时候呢，他脸上绝对不会写说我是菩萨，你根本不知道谁是菩萨。那么你看看你现在已经坐在旁边的，是哪一个菩萨示现，你也不知道，因为他不会告诉你。这个菩萨到世间游化是一个在家人的时候，除非他要走了，他才会告诉你。所以呢，因为菩萨呢，他要行菩萨道的时候，要叫做啊，用这种啊，叫做四摄法。四摄法里头有一个叫同事，就是跟你共事在一起，生活在一起。那在你生活中，他来教化你。可是呢，他示现的是一个普通人，你看不出来。所以观音菩萨会用这种方法啊，跟一个有缘的众生啊，来相处教化他。可是因为观音菩萨他是佛了。所以他一样跟释迦牟尼佛、可以示现千百亿化身的菩萨身去教化众生。也就是说，在十方世界中有多少这个众生跟观音菩萨有缘，观音菩萨就示现同等的身去教化他。所以呢，他一样跟佛的这种度化方式是一样的，只是他更方便。
So yes, the Guanyin Bodhisattva manifests as a Bodhisattva so that he can teach living beings who have that affinity, who wish to see a bodhisattva. And so in the sutra that says that there's two types of bodhisattvas, there's bodhisattvas who are left home, or monastics, and there's bodhisattvas who are householders, who are at home. So, for instance, the people sitting next to you, you don't know who could be a bodhisattva transformed to be a householder. And also the bodhisattva won't tell you, oh, I'm the bodhisattva, such and such. Only nearer the end of life does one, maybe this bodhisattva, reveal who he or she truly is. So there's because one of the four gathering in dharmas, that of similar work, or you could say of living together, of being together. And so the bodhisattva can use this way of gathering in so that to gather in living beings into the dharma. So the bodhisattva, Guanyin Bodhisattva, also has hundreds, thousands, millions, nayutas of Buddha, transformation bodies, so that he can teach and transform living beings, whomever he has affinities with, just like the Buddha.
法大呢，有一些事情，那我们把时间留给那个法大来宣布。
So Dharma Realm Buddhist University would like to share some news. So maybe the rest of the time we can allow Dharma Realm Buddhist University to make some announcements.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Wayne Chen. I see a lot of familiar faces in the audience today. As Dharma Master Fan mentioned, we are from the Dharma Buddhist University. I am here today as the Director of Admissions and Financial Aid for the Dharma and Buddhist University. To my far right, it's Christine Goh. She's the Director of Communications. And then to her left is Tao Fi. A lot of people in the Buddhist monastery in Berkeley knows her as Amanda. She recently joined us as a recruiter. So we'd like to take the next couple minutes to share some good news with everyone about the university. Very briefly, many people here have heard of the Dharma and Buddhist University. It was founded by Venerable Master Shenhua in 1976 in Ukiah, California, inside the City of 10,000 Buddhas. It was formed as a very important vehicle within Shifu, which is Venerable Master's plan to bring Buddhism into the West or into modern minds. So a lot of people associate with Venerable Master as the monk that's bringing Buddhism to the West. And he's doing it in a very organized and clear vision and plan. And many people here has heard that. So he's in his vision, a way to bring that Dharma to the West is by establishing a monastic sangha. As you see Dharma Master sitting to my left. He also had a vision and plan to actually translate the sutra texts into English and multiple languages as the way to continue the teaching of the Buddha. Third aspect of that is education. He established a university. He established the high school and elementary school, and I see several people here are the fruit and product of his educational programs, myself included. And lastly, engaging in deeply, which is championed by Reverend Heng Sure, interfaith dialogue. So within that master plan of bringing Dharma to the West, we are working on the university portion. Today, we came and bearing good news. University, within the last 6 months, have two major progress we'd like to share. First is that we are introducing two brand new programs. One for the undergraduate program, which is a four-year integrated primary text-based bachelor program. Okay. Second is the two-year master's program. Both of those programs were approved by the state of California as formal programs we can open and accept students to. Those two programs, the current faculty and staff work at the university for about 3 to 4 years. We wanted to design a program that really embodies all the elements of Shifu's teaching, and including the method of his ideas, and not to yield to the broad mainstream academia program. So we really, really cared about how to preserve the methods and the ideas that he has instilled in his schools, and especially direct instruction to the earlier disciples, including Reverend Heng Sure, including Dharma Master Heng Sure, Marty Verhoeven, and Doug Powers, and so on and so forth. So we're working with them to develop those two programs, and then now it's being approved by the state of California to open. The second important information that complements the first is that university has formally moved ahead on its accreditation process. So in October of this year, DRBU, the university, has passed the first of the three stages of becoming a fully accredited university. It was actually in Berkeley Buddhist Monastery, so I'm really happy to bring to break the news here, is that it was in the back room here where the entire leadership of the university had a conference call with the accreditation body known as WASC, stands for Western Association for Schools and Universities, who give accreditation to universities. So it was in that conference we presented our work and our plan. It was very, very quickly, they were absolutely impressed with the proposal, the innovative program, and then recommended, actually, that one of the lead commentator on the panel saying that this is the best, most well-prepared proposal in his years at WASC. So that was beyond our expectation in terms of the high remark. So again, this is I'm happy to be the conveyor of the work that the university is projecting, but I want to share that news with everyone that we are on our way to become a fully accredited institution. So I want to turn the microphone over to Tao to tell us about the program and Christine later to talk about recruiting efforts.
Like Wayne previously mentioned, we are really excited to introduce our two new degree programs. The teaching model behind the programs is primary text-based, which means the students learn directly from the text, and it allows them to gain a deeper understanding of the meaning behind the text, which is really rare in a contemporary academic setting. Our first undergraduate program is the Bachelor of Arts in Liberal Arts. It's a four-year program, which the curriculum covers a wide breadth of knowledge in the arts and the sciences. What makes the DRBU program unique is that it includes both the Buddhist, Chinese, and Indian primary texts in addition to the Western classics. So students would be directly learning from the Sharangama Sutra, the Avatamsaka Sutra, and the Lotus Sutra as examples. The two-year master's program is a Master of Arts in Buddhist Classics, and students gain a deeper understanding and appreciation for Buddhism through both Theravadan and Mahayanan sutras and texts. So to start the degree programs, we want to keep the class sizes small. And if you know someone or you are interested in learning more about the program, please feel free to ask one of us after lecture. And then Christine will tell you about our upcoming events.
It's on. So now that we have these new programs to launch, we're really excited to begin to share this news with as many people as we can. So in the upcoming months, we're going to be everywhere. And I'd like to tell you a little bit about where we're going to be. So today is the first of many of such announcements that we're going to be doing in various DRBA branch monasteries around the West Coast, first of all, and around the Bay Area. And we'll also be around in all of the big Dharma events that we'll be having at the City of 10,000 Buddhas throughout the spring and the summer. So look for us there. At the same time, in 2 weeks on February 9th in the afternoon, we're going to be at the Oakland Museum, and we'll be part of the Chinese New Year celebration there. We'll be sharing some of our materials, and we'll also be part of the Chinese New Year celebration in the San Francisco Chinatown on February 15 and February 16. So that'll be all day in Chinatown. I think we'll have a booth right outside Gold Mountain Monastery. So come say hi to us and learn about the university there. We'll also be joining several college fairs in the Bay Area throughout the spring months. All of this information, by the way, will be on our website. So if you know someone who's interested in the program, you can send them to some of our events. Our website is www.drbu.org, and you can find information about the events there. So also, I wanted to let you know that we'll be around after lecture to answer any questions you may have. We have a table set up in the back, and we've brought some information that you can take home with you. Among them are a Chinese brochure, and we also have a small English brochure, and we also have our view book, which gives a more comprehensive look at our program. So feel free to grab some of these materials on your way out and share them with anyone who might be interested in applying for the program. We do have a rolling admission, so we accept applications at any time that the student chooses to submit it, and then we will continue with recruiting until we've filled up our class. So come see us and get some information. Thank you.
So in the interest of time, we won't take questions here, but like Christine said, we'll be in the back. And also, if you feel free to take some of the souvenirs and the collaterals home to to people in your family or people that you know might be interested in the university. So now the door is open. Please help us share the news and then introduce university to people that you know or people who might be interested in studying here. Okay, Amitofo.
Amitofo. Yeah. Yeah, it was a lot of hard work. The program probably took about 2-3 years just to plan all the details out, to take a really solid academic program, but also in the spirit of the Buddhist tradition of awakening and liberation. So it's a really, it's actually a really, if you really look at it and understand it, it's actually very nuanced and very carefully done. And so that's why I was very happy. I think people were quite happy when WASC basically said, yeah, this is really good. We hope you do it. We want to support you in doing it. So, okay, tonight we have, we usually end our lectures, or we always end our lectures, with something called a dedication of merit. You should have it on your sheet in the back. I think Alan will be joining us with the guitar accompaniment. And so this is a time where we can basically take the merit from being together, tying up Dharma affinities, listening to Dharma, learning literary prajna, and then sending it out to other people or all beings with whatever wish you like. If it's for all beings to become Buddhas, or if there's a loved one that's sick, or if there's some type of pain in the world that you wish to remedy, this is one time you can, in your heart, send out all the goodness from our gathering to whatever you wish to send it to. So I invite everybody to join. You can put your palms together. Announcements. So I think people know Chinese New Year is coming up this Friday, January 31st. So we'll be having the monastery open during that time. We'll start at 9 a.m. We're going to recite Om Mani Padme Hum and have a couple talks and then have our vegetarian meal here, which for sure will be very good. We'll have a very good vegetarian lunch as usual. And on Saturday, we will continue with the Dharma assembly in the morning, but we want to give the cooks a break here because Friday night, I'm sure they'll be cooking up a storm. So Saturday, we won't have lunch here. But on Friday, we will have a Dharma assembly here. And Saturday, we'll have a Dharma assembly just in the morning. What else is happening is the new semester, we just heard from Dharma and Buddhist University, is starting up again. So this week, starting Monday, is actually going to be the classes. So for instance, people know Doug Powers, he was teaching a class called Buddhism and the Modern Mind. And that should be a really engaging class for not just young people, I mean, mostly for young people, but young at heart, who want to kind of engage Buddhism through very modern kind of hip topics. We're going to do that Monday night in the dining hall. So if you're interested, please check out the poster in the back. The other thing is we will be having Thursday roundtable starting this Thursday as well. And be alternating weeks, we're going to have a discussion on the 42-section sutra, trying to introduce some basic Buddhist topics. Friday night class with Marty, Professor Verhoeven, will be starting up as well on Friday nights at 7:30. And we'll have continue with our sutra lectures. Did I leave anything else out? I believe not this Sunday, but the following week, we'll have the Buddha recitation, the all-day Buddha recitation as usual. So that will start up again in February, the first Sunday of February. Any other? Oh, okay. Yeah. Wait, it takes a while.
Amitofo, everyone. As you all know, as a monk, I'm not part of DRBU, so I'm not being paid to say this. From what I understand about a DRBU degree program is that in terms of education and in terms of, if you look at it from a liberal arts degree, which is what it is probably the best you can get in the whole of the United States. If you compare to any other liberal arts degree, in terms of the quality of education that you will get. And if any of you believe in a Rambo Master's vision for education, this is it. And DRBU as a small school, it does not make sense to reach out like a big school. And if you understand the way DRBU works, it will attract very special students to DRBU. And one of the things is that as one of Rambo Master's disciples, if you're interested, and if you believe in the vision, word of mouth is a very powerful way to spread the word. So if you know of anyone who might be interested in looking at a school like DRBU, especially the environment that it provides, and the way, I'll just go back to saying that it's probably one of the best liberal arts degrees in terms of education quality that you can get. So DRBU needs all your help to spread the word. Thank you.
Okay, so for people, if you were going to stand up and bow to the Buddhas and the Venerable Masters, so if your legs let it get some blood, don't stand up too quickly. And if you're not comfortable bowing, no problem. Please feel free to just observe. Okay. Bow in respect to the Venerable Master. Namo da fang guang fo hua yan jing hua yan hai wei fo pu sai na.